Simon & Schuster Audio presents Trying to Float, Chronicles of a Girl in the Chelsea Hotel by Nicolaia Rips. Read by the author.
Prologue. It was 11 p.m. on the Saturday night just before Christmas, and I had been sent out by my parents to buy ice cream from the nearby Aristocrat Deli. As I waited for the elevator, I amused myself with a favorite activity, seeing how far I could pull the clasp on the ancient fire alarm without breaking its tiny glass tube. But that night, my chubby 7-year-old fingers slipped, and I clamped down hard on the lever. The fire alarms exploded through the hallways, and I kicked the pieces of glass behind a nearby garbage can. Neighbors swelled from their apartments. They carried guitars, guns, furs, paintings, and manuscripts, labored under mannequins and giant antique cameras. They yelled and grumbled, rubbed sleep from their eyes, and jostled each other, angry at having been forced out of their snuggeries. My mother, in a nightgown, picked me up in a one-arm hold that would shame a running back and raced us down the hotel's peeling iron staircase. In her other arm was a stack of brightly painted journals that documented her 30 years of travels throughout Asia, Africa, and the Middle East. Spices and flora she had dried and pressed in them escaped in a puff of fragrance as we ran. My father, trailing behind us in a mink-lined smoking jacket, cradled a bottle of gin. In the lobby, we were greeted by a crowd of men and women in silk dressing gowns, with smudged eyeliner and wigs awry, and in the middle of them, the angel, naked but for a white cloth wrapped around his groin and a luminous spread of feathers attached to his back. With no chance of returning to our rooms until firemen had canvassed the 10-story building, the mood in the lobby turned from communal annoyance to collective intoxication. Drinks courtesy of my father's bottle of gin and El Quijote, the ancient Spanish restaurant next door. People milled about catching up with neighbors. Relieved that I had not yet been arrested, which is not to say that others weren't that night, I walked outside. It was snowing, not white flakes, rose flakes, steeped in the dozen red letters that hung over the front door, Hotel Chelsea. The Fledgling Years. Chapter 1, My First Trip. 8 years into my parents' marriage, my mom discovered that she was pregnant. This seemingly joyous event was dented by my dad's denial that such a terrible thing could happen to him. Convinced that he wasn't responsible, he accused my openly gay godfather, Tom, of fathering the child. My mom was an extraordinary traveler, and though excited about the pregnancy, feared that a baby would signal the end of her journeys, she began to plan a trip to Iran. Because she needed a visa to get into Iran and couldn't get one in the United States, she flew to London and applied for her visa there. She was 5 months pregnant. In London, the Iranian consulate informed her that a visa could take months. Never one to wait around, she decided to travel the Uzbek Silk Road while waiting for her visa to arrive in Tashkent. An Iranian doctor in London gave her a note that said she could travel until 7 months pregnant. With this, she and I were off. Back in New York, my dad refused to admit that he had a wife, much less a daughter, on the way. This fantasy came to an end when he picked up his mail to find a postcard from a grinning woman, with a swelling belly, firing off automatic weapons with a group of equally happy Uzbek men. The caption read, "Enjoying the afternoon with your daughter." Acknowledging the imminent arrival of his daughter, my father, who had previously handled my mother's trips to the most dangerous parts of the world by confining himself to a 2-block radius that included the Chelsea Hotel, his favorite cafe, and his barber, now added visits to a psychiatrist to the mix. What she thought of his reflections on his childhood in Nebraska, vivid and unexpected, like pimentos in the center of olives, I dare not imagine. On July 19th, exactly 4 weeks before I was born, my father opened the door to find a woman wearing a burqa. When my mother went into labor at St. Luke's Roosevelt Hospital, my dad was finally forced to venture outside his circle of comfort. Having done so and meeting me, he realized it wasn't so bad out there. Chapter 2. Italy. Mother looked at father, father at mother, both at me, in my crib, and they decided that the best thing for the three of us was to move to Italy. To this day, I do not understand why, but I spent the next couple years crawling around a small town north of Rome called Sutri, while my mother painted and my father did God knows what. Mostly, he sat with the old men in the square. He spoke no Italian, relying instead on an array of confusing facial expressions. After Italy, we moved to North Africa and then to India. We lived in villages. My babysitters there didn't know the few words I had learned in Italy, so I became fluent in the same language of baffling facial expressions as my father. When we finally returned to the United States, we moved back to the Chelsea Hotel, known for its writers, artists, and musicians, but also for its drug addicts, alcoholics, and eccentrics. At any given time, at least one from each group was in the lobby. Since there were few children in the hotel, it was with these people that I spent my time. Chapter 3. Preschool. My earliest memories of my father are of him sitting in an armchair, me on his lap, reading to me from various books. Instead of the stories which you and I are so familiar and fond, Charlotte's Web, The Little Prince, he would convert whatever he was currently reading into a children's story. I suspect he did this not because he was lazy, which he most certainly was, but because he liked the challenge of turning The Idiot or Anything by Thomas Carlyle, his favorite, into a tale for five and under. This would have been harmless enough had he not believed that reading adult books to a child, followed by a discussion, was a more effective means of developing his daughter's mind than any of the usual methods. There were two effects of this, noticeable to everyone but my father. The reading and chatting continued well past when other parents began to teach their children to read, and the language of Carlyle began to seep into the soft brain of his child, me. After reading to me for a couple hours, my father would pack me up and take me to his favorite coffee shop on 8th Avenue. The big cup was brightly painted, filled with broken chairs and sofas, and, to my delight, had Barbie dolls nailed to the doors of the bathrooms. The dolls, mostly Kens, were naked. The coffee shop was popular with young men who looked like Ken and older men who wanted to meet young men who looked like Ken. I was the only child there, and as one of the first regular customers, I became a sort of mascot. By the time I was 4 and it had occurred to my parents that I should be in preschool, the schools near the Chelsea Hotel were full, so my parents put my name on waiting lists, with my father placing asterisks next to those schools closest to his favorite coffee shops, but there was little hope. In the meantime, I passed my days in the hotel lobby and the big cup, talking to the residents and regulars. One day, my parents received a call from a school in the neighborhood. A spot had opened up, but because there were others on the waiting list, the head of the school wanted to interview us all before deciding who would be admitted. Though a foreign concept to me at the time, parents in Manhattan are beset with the school system, believing that the right preschool is essential to getting their kid into the right elementary school, middle school, high school, college, and so on. The competition is so great that parents pay people to prepare their families for the interviews. The coaches go so far as to pick out the clothing the family will wear. The school that called my parents was on West 14th Street in an area called the Meatpacking District. It was once a center for butchering meat and is now filled with fancy shops. Because of the school's reputation as creative and safe, it was attended by the sons and daughters of famous actors and actresses who lived in the neighborhood. So well known was the school that the headmistress was a neighborhood celebrity, fawned over by conniving parents. Upon entering the school, my parents and I were escorted into a waiting room. The headmistress, we were told, would be with us in a few minutes. Also in the room were another mother, father, and a young boy. The child was wearing khaki pants, a blazer, and a tie. I was wearing my favorite shirt and top, made out of a bright, shimmery fabric which my mom had bought for me in Morocco. Since the outfit was several years old, the top was no longer within sight of the skirt, and the skirt was much tighter and shorter than it was meant to be. There was a matching headscarf. The secretary instructed me and the other child to take a seat next to each other on the couch. Sitting there,
we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.